So how does our spirit sound? Now, if you're a veteran and you've walked with God for many years, you probably have worked out your way of hearing what your spirit man is saying. But I believe, the truth be told, most people do not know what their spirit man sounds like. And so in my experience, derived from my own experimentation, I found that early on in life, that when I had tears, it was usually around a God moment. Now I'm talking about the God kind of tears. I'm not talking about pain, sorrow, remorse, regret, those kinds of things. I'm talking about the God kind of tears. When I had tears, it was around a God moment. And I got to asking myself, this is kind of new territory. Not many people talk about it. And so we kind of just had to find this out on the school of life, you know? And so what does it mean? Why am I having tears? What does that signify? I came to find out that everybody has tears at different moments or in different environments or around different influences. And I thought, well, why is that, God? I think it's because of the difference in each of us, that we're made different. We're wired different. We're created differently in God's eyes, under His hands, His molding. He creates us differently, and He knows just the certain kind of godly environment that will speak uniquely to our spirit man. Now, there's a general presence of God that hovers over all of us all the time. And of course, the presence of God is within us. But then there's these special times, it seems like, when the uniquely, if I could say it this way, shape of the Spirit of God meets the unique shape of our spirit. Now, obviously, that's not accurate, but that helps us maybe with a human way to see it. When that unique shape of God sits upon the unique shape of us, then there's this pulsating, vibrating synergism thing that goes on. And Isaiah 66 verse 2 calls it, "And those who tremble at my voice." That's a biblical concept. When the presence of God is in upon us or within us or stirs in us in such a way that it's uniquely fashioned the way we are made, then there is a reciprocal response from us. Again, Isaiah 66 verse 2, "And those who tremble at my voice." Well, then I had to ask myself, well, what does that mean? Why would my spirit man be trembling? Why would it be stirred? And maybe when my neighbor is not stirred in the same way, what does that mean? Well, I begin to decipher that is a unique method, a unique way. It's kind of like a unique language that we have with God, my spirit and God's spirit. Now, the more we develop that, the more we develop an awareness to communicate in that language, the more it becomes easier and easier then to take note of not just tears anymore, which those are always good, I love tears, but now it's the stirrings that happened way before tears ever appeared. It's the deeper, it's the more subtle, the more central part of us, and we've become more now in tuned with those stirrings, so that we don't have to wait for tears to come before we realize, oh, God is doing something, saying something, or my spirit man is trying to get my attention. You know, there's the old kind of, it's pretty crass, but you know, the saying said, what does it take, a two before to get your attention? No. We want to develop our capacity to be sensitive to God on the most gentle stirrings, so that All it takes is a little brush, just a little brush of his spirit on our spirit, and our spirit man goes, oh yeah, there's God. And then our spirit man begins to speak to us the understanding of what that little brush meant. In the beginning, it will be so simple as to just affirm that we're in the right place at the right time. This, whatever it is, wherever we're at, is God's spirit witnessing to our spirit. Our spirit man witnessing, bearing witness with his spirit that this is God's affirmation. It's like him saying, good boy, Mark. Good boy, Marky boy. You bumbled into it. You stumbled into it. Well, somewhere along the line, we begin then to finding those places on purpose, with intentionality. We begin to listen, begin to know the nuances of God, and we begin to stir and maneuver our life based on what we know now to be true, taking us into the very presence where God's spirit and our spirit man can commune. So, like I said, probably anybody who's a veteran who walks with God for any number of years, you probably discovered your own way. It may not have the same kind of MO, may not look the same the way I do, the way mine does, but the good part about it is God has the capacity to have a very personal language with each of us. Let me just read a chat here. Somebody said something. Does our spirit man ever unite with Holy Spirit? Well, let's take a look at John 17. Jesus said, Father, I desire that they would be one with me, even as you and I are one. You and me, I and you, us in them and them in us. In my prayer document a while ago, I used the word homogenized. Homogenized. Now you and I, we buy homogenized milk, if we buy dairy milk, and it's been homogenized. Homogenized means some process has been done where you can't separate the cream from the skim milk. It has now been blended together to where it can't be separated. I believe that was the essence of Jesus's prayer. Father, blend them together with me, and us in them, and them in us. Now, at first, that occurs only, or I should say primarily at least, in our spirit man. That's Colossians 3, verse 1. For since you have been raised. When did you get raised? At salvation. Your spirit man got raised. You got blended in to the Spirit of God. Let me just finish this text and I will then get back here. Yeah, so our spirit man is come into, I believe, unity with the Spirit of God. Now, what we want to do, and what should just really rise up inside of us is, God, I want to know that communion that your spirit and my spirit are having. I want to be cognizantly aware of it. And then I want to participate with it. I want to not just agree with it, but I want to move with you in that union, that common union that is occurring between my spirit and God's spirit. So when we call our spirit to attention, is it to surrender to the Holy Spirit? Then we can unite when we tell our mind and soul body to come into your authority under our spirit. Yes. I'm saying to my spirit man, I call you to attention. I authorize you. I validate you today. And I commission you to stand tall in God's ordained position for you to be leader over my being under, listen, under Holy Spirit's leadership. So obviously, Holy Spirit is the superior position over our triune self, our spirit, soul, and body. And so we're telling our spirit man, listen to Holy Spirit, but now I call you into leadership over my soul and my body. All right. I hope we haven't belabored the point. Does that seem okay to everybody? Two things for me. Over time, remember I said that one of the first things is tears. I think we all have tears. I've only met a few people who did not have tears. And so almost all of us have tears. And I think that is one of your first ways to begin to get in touch with your spirit man. The next thing is you probably have experienced other bodily sensations, such as chills, such as shaking, or as Sherry pointed out, that kind of tight feeling atop of your head, which I really identify with. I've felt that for many years. And so there are lots of different ways. If we begin to take note of those and begin to journal them, maybe not on paper, but certainly in our mind, begin to decipher, analyze, why did I have that? What happened just before? What happened after that? So after a while, those can all be added together to be our composite language that we hear. Then eventually, and this is kind of where I'm at now, is there's a stirring. Like just right now, as I just spoke, there was something went from the back of my head down on the inside of me that was kind of the what I call the witness of my spirit with God's spirit. That witness. Now, at first, it is too intangible to take note of. So it seems like God actually allows that little stirring to actually have an expression of a you might call it chills or tingles. They kind of go like that. Or many times it's down my right arm. If it's really profound, it goes down both legs. And it's just like, okay. And when that happens at this point in my life, I am fearless. I know that's the witness of God's spirit upon my spirit that says, you are tracking with me. And so that makes me fearless. You know, the psalmist said I could run through a troop or leap over a wall. Why? Because he had the witness, in my words, the witness of the affirmation of God upon him. Now, I wanted to bring, oh yes, one other thing is when I'm prophesying, I don't call myself a prophet, but I do believe we can all prophesy. So when I'm prophesying, there are lots of thoughts go through our mind. We're talking, how do we determine between a voice of concern, a voice of worry, a voice of fear, or the voice of our spirit man? You know, how do we determine that? How do we decipher? Well, when I'm prophesying, again, all of us will have our unique way of figuring this out, but when I'm prophesying, all these thoughts may be going through your mind. You've got this person in front of you, this situation, and you know things in the natural. Well, when I'm processing, or when I'm aware of thoughts that have a beginning place and an end place, I usually do not give attention to those because I see those as coming from my mind. But here's the cool thing, and again, this may not be true for everybody. I can be praying along for somebody, and then a thought will just come down like this over the front of my awareness, not in my eyes, but in the front of my awareness, a thought that didn't have any tie to anything else before it or even after it. It just is a thought. In this stage of my life, I have come to see that as the voice of Holy Spirit and my spirit becoming aware of it, and now I can begin to move on it. Now, we could go on for probably another hour, and we still wouldn't exhaust all the different ways. And I think it comes down to, the Bible says, let every man work out his salvation with fear and trembling. not work out your way for atonement. But once you've experienced atonement and salvation, now work out your journey with God with fear and trembling. In other words, God, I'm serious about this. I want to be able to track with you and with my spirit, man. So I'm going to leave it at that.